word. It reads this, and this is not my actual text. This is just an intro text. It says, and he said to them, follow me as my disciples, accepting me as your master and teacher and walking the same path of life that I walk. And I will make you fishers of men. That's my first text. And it's just an intro text because I want you to understand when Jesus is talking about following him, he says, if you're going to follow me, you have to walk the same path of life that I walked. And the people of the day were just following him just to follow. There was no real commitment. Let me say that again. They were following him just to follow, but there was no real commitment. Turn to your neighbor and say, are you committed?
Are you committed?
Everybody's saying, yeah. Are you committed? Okay. Like we're committed, right?
It's like bacon and egg. Come on. Man.
After today, you'll probably go to lunch and say, I don't know if I'm really committed.
Okay?
No, I hope you don't say that. Here's my text this morning, okay? It's a long text. Normally, I only read portions of it, but I just feel led that we should read the whole thing so that you have a better grasp, and then we'll kind of do a kind of verse-by-verse breakdown of certain key things that I think Jesus is trying to teach us this morning. It's Luke chapter 14, verses 25 through 35, and this is the New Living Translation. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for our guest. We thank you, Lord, for bringing Jessica home to us, Lord, safely.
Hey, hey, hey.
We thank you for Sister May's nephew for being in our house. We thank you for all our other guests that I have not mentioned. Lord, thank you for the household of faith. I thank you, Lord, that this is our second Sunday after a wonderful, wonderful celebration of 20 years. Father, I don't know where everybody is, Lord, but you know where they are. But Father, I just pray, Lord Jesus, as we start this new series, I pray, Lord, spiritual alignment, Lord, that you will teach us your ways. You will wake us up, Lord Jesus, truly wake us up to who we should be in you. What a true disciple should be. As you teach us the definition of discipleship, that Father, we will be open, Lord Jesus, to all the things that you will point out to us, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that if there is tweaking in our lives, if there's adjustments, if there be alignment in our life that needs to be made, that it is your Holy Spirit, Lord Jesus, that will bring us to this truth. As you hide me behind your precious cross this morning and impart your truths to your people, I thank you again, Lord Jesus, as we start a new series. I thank you for, again, everything that you continue to do in the lives of your people. In your mighty name we pray and everybody says,
amen.
Amen. Amen. It reads this, a large crowd was following Jesus. He turned around and said to them, if you want to be my disciple, you must, by comparison, hate everyone else. Your father, your mother, your wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even your own life. Turn to your neighbor and say, whoa.
Whoa.
That's a lot. It's pretty heavy, right? Jesus is pretty heavy here because he knows there's a lot of people that are following him, right? And then he drops the hammer. He says, otherwise, you cannot be my disciples or disciple. And if you do not carry your own cross and follow me, you cannot be my disciple. But don't begin until you count the cost. For who will begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there's enough money to finish it? Otherwise, you might complete only the foundation before running out of money. And then everyone would laugh at you. They would say, there's a person who started that building and couldn't afford to finish it. Or what king would go to war against another king without first sitting down with his counselors to discuss whether his army of 10,000 could defeat the 20,000 marching against him? And if he can't, he will send a delegation to discuss terms of peace while the enemy is still far away. So you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own. Interesting. Then he goes on and does another illustration. Salt is good for seasoning. How many of you love salt?
Hey.
Nothing tastes good without salt.
Amen.
MSG, right? Bro. Monosodium glutamate.
French fries without salt?
Oh, potato.
Salt without salt?
That's right. Salt on salt.
But if it loses its flavor, how do you make it salty again? Flavorless salt is good neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown away. Anyone who hears, with ears to hear, should listen and understand. Amen? So, this is Jesus. He speaks through Dr. Luke, and Dr. Luke is conveying to us what it is to be a follower of Jesus Christ or a disciple. And now, as I said, he drops a hammer because there's these multitudes following him. And he doesn't know, well, I shouldn't say he doesn't know, because he knows why they're following him. And this is the reason why he does what he does. He tells them, if you want to be a follower of mine, he first tells them, if you want to be a follower, you have to hate your mother, your father. Ouch. That doesn't make sense to me. In fact, when I think about that, what was he trying to do? Today, many people do not understand what it means to be a Christian or a genuine Christian. I talk about a genuine profession of faith. Billy Graham's crusade, tens of thousands come up and make a profession of faith. But is it genuine? And the reason why I ask that genuine profession of faith is because when they go away from making that profession of faith, does their life change? Is there fruit from that profession of faith? Is there a reflection in their life or a reflection of Jesus Christ? And if the answer to that is an emphatic no, then it wasn't genuine. Amen? In other words, they just went up there just to see Billy Graham. Because to be honest with you, I think I got saved a couple of times. I wanted to see Billy Graham. I was saved already, but because we had nosebleed section, right? You ever go to one of his crusades? Just be honest, right? You want to see Billy Graham because he's kind of like a prophet of the time, and you want to see what he looks like. I only seen him on magazines or pictures. In fact, I think my son just came back from Charlotte, and I told him, did you get saved again in Billy Graham's house? Right? Because he was sharing with me that they gave you these placards to say, you know, you wanted to make a profession of faith. Well, I would have got saved. I could say I got saved by Billy Graham. You guys aren't getting that. Say, Pastor Ben, you only get to be saved once.
It's powerful.
Amen. But it's just something for us, because I know that there is ignorance. I know that people just don't comprehend what it means to be a Christian. And today, our society today, people like to be called Christian. People want people to know that they're Christians, but unfortunately, they just play the role. Just like these people that wanted to say they were associated or were followers of Jesus. There are a lot of people, let me enumerate these things. There are a lot of people that go to church. They come to church. I'm in church. I sing the songs, right? I sing the songs, and I sing the songs really well. In fact, I know the songs really well. I know them by heart, right? So I sing the songs. I even do something bigger than most people. I tithe.
You can say that.
And they tithe, right? They pray. The Bible says of these things. These are people that do all these things. But the Bible says they're not genuine Christians. It's just show. And the thing is Jesus here is trying to show us something here. It's not the things that you do. It's the relationship that you have.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
Because I can send my wife flowers all the time. I can take my wife to dinner. But if I don't really have a relationship with her, I can do all the things that husbands do. But unless I actually have a relationship and nurture that relationship, then we really don't have what we call a marriage today. I'm just kind of going through the motions. I'm acting the part. And unfortunately, that's the same way people are when we think of disciples. They act the part, but they're not really followers of Jesus Christ. So I have a certain point that's coming up. We know that the Bible speaks of being a disciple. The Bible says here in this wonderful thing about computers, right? It says the term disciples occurs 269 times. Would I have known that? No. But that's interesting to note, because a follower of Jesus and a disciple are one and the same word. It's no different than a wife and a spouse. We use two words that define who a person is. And in the Bible, when it talks about disciples and followers, basically they are what we call Christians today. This morning, I got a singular point I want to expound on, and that point is committed above everything. We're committed above everything. In other words, if you are a disciple of Jesus, you are committed above everything. Let me say that again. If you were a disciple of Jesus Christ, you are committed to Jesus above everything. Above the Raiders, above everything. Above the Warriors, above everything. Above the Niners, above everything. Above my wife. Right? I mean, when you think about that, Jesus, he doesn't mince any words here. And he says, when you are committed above everything, one of the things that he wants to emphasize, he says here, he emphasizes there are large numbers of people that are following Jesus. And what does that word really mean? It means this: they followed him because there was something that they were looking for, something that they were wanting from him. And the thing is in the church, we are people that are following Jesus too. There are people in the church that are following Jesus because Jesus is who other people receive blessings from. And because they're getting blessed, that's why we have what we call today the prosperity teaching, the feel-good teaching. And there are a lot of people flocking to these churches. How many want to be blessed? You have to raise your hand. Hey, yeah, okay, you don't want to be blessed, but that's okay. Don't worry, God still blesses you, all right? But the thing is how many people want to be blessed, and all of a sudden people want to go to these teachings where that's all they talk about, the good things about Christianity. You know, you want to be blessed, you want to go to a church where the pastor or the teacher teaches on you being blessed all the time. There's no suffering, right?
Yes.
There's no type of chastisement, meaning any type of God telling you you shouldn't have done that, right? There is, you know, it's just all feel-good messages, you know? And a lot of people flock to that. And, of course, the biggest thing on these feel-good messages is you want to be rich? You want to be rich? Follow Jesus Christ. If you want to be rich, follow Jesus Christ. God will prosper you. God will bless you. God will give you everything you could possibly need. And who wouldn't want to be part of that? You know, I think about that all the time when we have little things that come up. My son, Chris, is away in Disneyland, and I had to tell him the bad news while he was in Disneyland that his tranny is gone. Yep. I thought about that. I said,
car.
He's in the most happiest place in the world, and Dad's going to call him to tell him that your transmission is gone. But guess what? It still didn't take away the joy of being in Disneyland, okay? Because he knew that Dad was going to take care of him. Okay? The large crowds, that's right.
My car.
That's right. And that's, you know what? I just thought about something just now. It's the same way when you think about this commitment. People come to church because they know that if they come to church, that Dad's going to take care of it. Right? If I come to church, Dad's going to take care of it. Unfortunately, they're not there to have a relationship with Dad. Because when Dad puts certain demands on you, has certain expectations on your life, expects you to do and fulfill certain things in your life, right?
Yes.
Then you start to say, well, maybe I really don't want to be part of that. Suffering? Me suffer. Nobody likes it. To be honest with you, the Bible tells us that we will endure suffering, right? But come on, we're not masochists. How many of us want to suffer? Right? This is where you don't raise your hand. Okay? None of us wants to suffer. We know. I don't want to. I mean, any Christian preacher that says, I want to suffer, I'm not following him. Because none of us wants to suffer. But this is the intention, because God knows the suffering part is to initially draw us near to God. Because some of us, we just don't get it. There is a lot of brethren here that should be here. And I'm saying this. There are a lot of brethren that were kind of looky-loos. They would come to church, and it's throughout the body of Christ. They come to church, and they feel good, but then when God allows, because we live in a fallen world, the suffering to take place in their life, they do this to God. They go away from church because they are not grounded in His Word, and they don't understand to be grounded in His Word is to know that God's relationship that you are establishing is going to see you through it. There's a lot of people that don't quite understand that, church. No, I don't want to suffer. But God allows this so that we could draw near to Him. That I can't take this by myself. I can't endure this by myself. I need God in my life to give me godly perspective as I endure this. And then when I come through it, now I can raise my hands in the air just like I don't care. Right? That's the reason why we do it. Because we know I could not have gone through that by myself. It was God that got me through that. Amen? Yep, those large crowds were wonderful, but the thing is, Jesus wanted them to understand, if you want to be my disciple, you must. You must do these things. And people say, well, see, there are do's and don'ts in Christianity. Well, this is where Jesus was trying to thin the crowd out. Because there were a lot of people that were following Him for their own intentions. And God wanted to remind them, if you really want to be a follower of mine, then you need to say to yourself and ask the same question. Because there are people in churches today that they don't want certain expectations on them. And I found this online. It's called the Light Church. Not light as in light bulb, but light meaning less filling. Right? 24% fewer commitments. Meaning, if you come to this church, not this church, the Light Church. If you come to the Light Church, you don't have to commit yourself. In fact, you don't even have to tithe. Only 7.5%. Just some of you, right? In fact, Pastor Ben won't speak more than 15 minutes. But you get to sing for 45. Because we all love to sing, right? Even if we can't sing, right? So this is called the Light Church. And then, of course, you know, you don't really have to participate in the Ten Commandments. Only 8 of your choice. So if I want to covet my sister's car, right? Well, that doesn't fall under one of those commandments, right? Right? It's everything you want in the church and less. It's a wonderful thing when you think about Christianity, because unfortunately, you know, the reality of Christianity is God takes away certain things. And these are things that when you think about God, some of you are probably thinking, there are don'ts in the church then. Yes, there are. Mm-hmm. Because there are certain parameters that God is trying to tell you that in order to be in the body of Christ, there are certain things that you should comply to. It's no different than, you know, there's rules for almost everything. If you drive, there's rules, right? If you play basketball, there's rules. Not today in the professional ranks. Now I've noticed the guys literally get killed out there. Right? I mean, but there are rules in order for us to follow. And it's the same way when you think about Christianity. So, we know that there were multitudes that were following Jesus Christ, but they weren't committed above everything. Amen? And of course, committed about everything, and then Jesus goes and says something very harsh. He says, you have to be committed above, by comparison, hate everyone else. It means all your other relationships. couldn't grasp this until I saw that word. It says, your relationships, your father, your mother, your wife. And notice it says your wife, but it doesn't say your husband. So why do you have to love your husband, but I could hate my wife? No, it doesn't say that, right? Right? It says, by comparison, hate everyone else, your father, your mother, your wife, your children, your brothers and sisters. In other words, what does that all mean? What is God saying here when he uses that very strong word right there, hate? And it actually means that it's a lesser form of love. In other words, I love God. I love God. And I love my wife. But God is saying, I need to love him more than I love my wife. Right? I need to love God more than I love my fiance. More than my boyfriend or my girlfriend. I need to love God more than my father and my mother. In fact, your relationships, your earthly relationships, are a distant second from God. Some of us struggle with that. And this is where God, when he talks about that, because he knows that relationships have a way of getting in the way of your commitment to God. You know, when you're dating, and you're dating somebody that is not of the same faith, that relationship will get in the way of God. Unfortunately, we fall in love with people, and the Bible teaches us that make sure that they love the same God that you love. Amen. And if they love the same God that you love, then my blessings, yes. Amen. Yes, right? But if they don't love the same God that you love, and the way I'll know this is, hey, when you get involved with some young person, or you're involved with somebody, ask them, what do you do on Sundays? If they tell you, well, I like to go to the games, or I like to just do nothing, ask them, do you go to church? And they say, what's church? Leave. I don't care if they're fine. Okay? Leave. Because you know what? Unfortunately, in the body of Christ, we'll see that first initial appearance thing, and we'll think, maybe I could win them to the Lord.
That's right.
You're not. No, there are times people will say, well, I've done that. Well, that's great. But win them to the Lord before you even start anything. You heard that, right? If there's nothing there, just friends, if you can't win them to the Lord, then leave. You're just heading down a dangerous path. And the Bible is very strong about this. Talks about the relationships. In fact, when Jesus says that you have to hate everyone else, he's saying that you have to love them less than who he is in your life. And nice. When I think about that, Jesus is actually talking about relationships, but I've heard other speakers talk about hobbies and clubs and other extracurricular activities. The thing is, I don't think he really meant that, because I have to look at the context of this. He talks about relationships. Many of you don't know my personal testimony is I have a family that behaves a certain way, and they behave in a way that's contrary to the way I behave. I used to drink. In fact, I used to love to drink. I thought drinking was great. In fact, Jesus turned water to wine, right? And I used to justify that. If Jesus turned water to wine, I heard a comedian once say that he turned water to wine just to keep the party going. Right?
Hey, you showed him.
You guys don't get this. I'm going to get there.
Hey, that's because
conviction. But you know, this is true when you think about that. And the thing is I justified all this until I started to see the magnitude of what this behavior did to people.
Yeah.
And I started to see, is that person a reflection of what Jesus Christ would be? And it bothered me. It bothered me hard. And then I desired to become a pastor. I desired to be a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I said, would that be a reflection of who I am? Now, I'm not saying that if those of you that are partaking in the vine, You know, I'm just telling you, the Bible tells us, it doesn't say that it is sin. It says it's not wise. I'll make sure you're clear on that. It's not wise. Because if you're a mother or a father, and your son or your nephew or your relations have been killed by a drunk driver, how are you going to come to your pastor and say, why? And I'm going to tell you why. It's because there are people that fall into this lie from the devil that when these commercials come on, they're talking about alcoholic beverages and they tell these people, but drink wisely. How stupid is that? Did I say stupid? I did. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
My dad used to tell me, don't ever say stupid. How dumb is that, right? I mean, it is, because being somebody that used to partake in this, I knew after my first or second, I was no longer wise. I wasn't thinking with great clarity anymore. So how do you expect these same people in your dumb commercial to understand that?
Dumb is just as bad.
So Jesus is trying to teach us something here when he talks about relationships. And he basically in the text reminds us that you need to be committed above your relationships. And when my family, when they partake with this, I didn't like being around them. And this was hard for me and my wife, because my wife would see that I struggled with this. And I said to her, I can't be here. And it was hard for me because I love my family, but I couldn't be part of that. So this struggle took place in my life. And I said, honey, you go, but I can't go. I won't go, because that internal struggle is going to be there. In fact, my family would always come to me, hey, you want one, man? And I would always say, I'm not about that anymore. Right? In fact, hallelujah is there, right? I used to tell them that, I'm not about that. And in fact, I would be so bold to say, I'm about my father's business. It was kind of hard. To be honest, the first time I said that, it didn't come out bold. It came out like, I'm about my father's business. Right? Because I was afraid. I was afraid this was my family, and I didn't want them to look at me in a way that was bad. But then, as the Holy Spirit began to fortify me, as the Word of God began to do things in my life, I was able to say that with great conviction and great boldness. I am about my Father's business. And you know what? To God be all the glory. I was honest with you, okay? So Pastor Ben, I was a little transparent, right? But this is sometimes when we think about what Dr. Luke is talking about, sometimes in your life you will have to make a choice. Did I want to make that choice? Of course I don't want to make it. And to be honest with you, my family came to respect that to some degree. They weren't happy that I was always there, but I would disappear. If I started to see this come out, I would say, hey, you know, I got to go. Right? I didn't take my family with me all the time. But I did go on my own, and I would go home. So, you know, God is trying to teach us this, and he's teaching this when he talks about this. And we need to look at the cost. And when we look at this, he uses his illustrations. And I'm going to keep going here in Luke chapter 14, verses 31 and 33. Real quick, he says this, and I won't read the whole thing. He says, what king would go to war against another king without first sitting down with his counselors to discuss this? So in other words, Luke talks about the cost. Do you measure the cost? To be a follower of Jesus Christ means you have to consider the cost. Anybody that tells you Christianity is not hard, they're lying. Mm-hmm. Christianity is hard, but does not take away from the grace of God. It does not. It's not a matter of works. It's a matter of being committed to Jesus Christ. And when he talks about the cost, making sure that you understand that there are certain things that are required. You can't go into Christian life thinking that nothing's required of me, because then it wouldn't be a life in itself. Amen? And then he talks about some other illustration here, and he talks about salt. He says salt is good for seasoning. Again, the Christian, we are to be salt to the world. I love that word. It says
salty.
if it loses its
flavor.
Turn to your neighbor and say, I love flavor.
Flavor.
Right?
Flavor.
In fact, flavor. Food with salt, it's delicious, right?
Bam.
I went and we had some barbecue at the Sugi household. I'm sorry, Sister Belen's household. We went over there, we had a celebration over there, and the food was so delicious. They're not good, it's to die for, right? If that vegetable dish, if it didn't have salt,
work.
Right? If French fries didn't have salt,
potatoes.
Right? Now, I'm here, God is talking about things and salt, and we recognize that things that have salt on them have flavor. It's the same way in Christianity. That Christians bring flavor to life.
Hey, come on then.
When you come into a room, when you come into a relationship, when you come anywhere you go, you bring flavor.
Spice.
Your Espanol spice. Okay? I mean, to me, when I think about this, God is reminding us that it's this wonderful flavor, and it's not the flavor of foods, it's a flavor of Christ. Jesus Christ uses another text about this rich or this fragrant offering. And when you bring Jesus Christ into a relationship, you bring Jesus Christ into a room, there is a certain amount of flavor that you bring, that you emanate, because people recognize the person who you are. And it's Jesus Christ in you. And I love when people tell me that when they go to work or they go to school and they get together with their friends who are believers too, that they have church, it's a rich flavor that comes together. Yes. And this is something that Jesus Christ is trying to teach us when we think about discipleship. Amen?
Amen.
And then he goes on even stronger here because he says about a relationship to your external friends, but then Jesus tells us that we need to be committed above everything, yes, even your own life. That's kind of scary, because if you want to be a follower of Jesus Christ, yes, even your own life, that means if you're a young person like yourselves, have certain dreams, aspirations, goals in life, right? You want to go on to higher education, maybe you want to be this, maybe you want to be that. You want to have a certain profession, maybe whatever it is. You want to achieve certain things. You know, I think that's one of the hardest things when we think about following Jesus Christ, when we think about our dreams, our wants, our desires. And God says that you need to yield those things to me. And I don't know if that's something that many Christians, I know that they all struggle with this, because when I was a young youth pastor, my brother came to me, he was a young brother at the time. He came to me, we were living on the east side of town, and he came to me and he wanted to talk to me. And he was in college at the time, and he was telling me that he is drawn to be a pastor. And I know that his parents at the time wanted him to be something of a certain profession, a vocation, whether it be an engineer, a lawyer, or a doctor. He could have been anything he wanted. But he said that he felt the call of God to be a pastor. Pastors don't make money. And in our culture, when your children are bright and they have everything going for them, sometimes as a parent, you want your children to do better than you do, right? There isn't a parent here that doesn't want their children to achieve greater than what they achieve. So if you compel your kids to get great education, if they can be a doctor and a lawyer, engineer, an architect, where they're making six figures a year better than you did, then that's great, right? But if your daughter or your son tells you, I want to be a missionary, I'm called to be an evangelist, I'm called to be a pastor, and I'm going to go to school for this. What? Are you kidding me? I didn't send you to UC Davis to become an engineer so that you could become a pastor. And unfortunately, there's the internal struggle. Yes, even your own life. It's scary. And I know that. Because there's a wonderful story here that I'm going to read real quick. It's found in Mark chapter 10. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. And, "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit the eternal life?" "Be a follower of Jesus Christ." "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony, you shall not defraud, honor your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all these things I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. There is no condemnation for those of us in Christ Jesus. "One thing you lack," Jesus said, "go and sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." And at this, the man's face fell, and he went away sad because he had great wealth. So basically, yes, even your own life, he had a life. He had a life of wealth. But he asked the teacher, Jesus, "How must I inherit eternal life? How must I be a follower of you? Because I recognize that you are good. I recognize there is something about you that is greater." God is telling us, yes, even your own life. It means that if God calls you into the ministry, he tells you that you need to love God even greater than your mom and dad's desires. Amen. You didn't hear that. Because if you do what your mom and dad tell you to do instead of God, you're out of the will of God. And mom and dad, I know we're all looking at this and saying, "No, that can't be right." Yes, it is right. Because if you choose your son and daughter's vocation above God's, and you call yourself a Christian, you're out of the will of God. Your son and daughter will be miserable for the rest of their life. Because God will chase them and chase them and chase them like Jonah. Just like Jonah. Because God has a purpose for your children's life. And you know, it's amazing to me, as a pastor, you know how many children I've dedicated? I can't even count anymore. Moms and dads, you bring their kids up here, "Pastor, I'd like to dedicate my daughter. I'd like to dedicate my son." They don't understand that dedication means, there's symbolism behind that. Literally means, I give my son and daughter to the service of the King. Whatever God intends for my son and daughter, to God be all the glory. But there's no way they're not going to be a pastor. There's no way I'm going to send them to the Middle East to be a missionary. To God be all the glory. You know, I know it's kind of scary and kind of scares me when I think about that. But God knows what's best. He says, yes, even your own life. You know, when I think about some of the things, and you're probably wondering who that brother is. Last Sunday during the celebration, God bless you, Jason Taggarin was here. And Jason was that young man. Jason could have been anything he wanted to. He could have built nuclear bombs if he wanted to. He was that brilliant. I mean, you know, to be honest with you, we had kids in my youth group that an A in their report card was nothing. In fact, A++ maybe. It depends on how many pluses. In fact, I never thought of the graduating class of the salutatorian or the valedictorian that there are increments after the 4.0. I always thought 4.0 was great. 1600 on the SAT, that's great, right? But for you to say 4.7, 8, 9, 6 differentiates you from somebody that got a 5 at the end, so you become the valedictorian. Are you crazy? And it's true.
Weighted grades, it's different.
But for the sake of the call, You become a pastor to God be all the glory. Because you know that that is the will of God for you. And it's not about being a six-figure person. It's about serving God for your purpose. Because that's who God, why God intended for your life. Again, mom and dad, to take a little heat off of you, you can serve God in the marketplace. You can serve God in the sanctuary. I'm just reminding you that. But if God calls you into the sanctuary, your son or daughter, to be a pastor, yield to the will of God. Amen? Yield to the will of God. If God calls your son or daughter to be a doctor, they'll serve God in the marketplace. Amen? Then he goes on and he says this. This is my last of the points, committed above all else. He said, and if you don't carry your own cross, you cannot be my disciple. It's kind of harsh. The cross was a cruel symbol of punishment. It's a literal punishment that the people that were crucified had to carry a cross when they were going to get crucified. Basically saying to the people as they're watching them as they carry the cross, and I'm not trying to be sad or funny with this, but if you're carrying a cross, you're basically telling everybody, bye, I'm getting ready to die, right? I'm going to get ready to be crucified. My life is over. This was God's literal symbol when he says, and if you do not carry your own cross and follow me, you cannot be my disciple. The cross was a symbol of reminding people of your imminent death. So you were basically telling people that I was going to die. So to carry your own cross, Jesus was reminding us that when you gave your life to Jesus Christ, you told God, not my will be done, but your will be done. Everything in my life from this day forward is your life. My dreams, my desires are your dreams and desires. My wants and my survival are on you, Christ Jesus. And when you hold to that belief and you hold to that hope and the trust in God, you're able to commit above everything. And I look at this and I used to tell God, maybe that's why a lot of people that call themselves Christians don't want to wear a cross. Anybody here wearing a cross? Everybody's hiding them now, right? I'm buttoning up, right? It's like people that, the fishy symbol on your cars. Same thing. Do you ever see a fish on the cars? Identifies you as a Christian, right? So when people see that, that's symbolism of the cross. It tells people that you are a follower of Jesus Christ, a disciple of Jesus Christ. Some of you that see a fish and you see some Greek letters in there, right? Jesus Christ, God's Son, Savior. You see that, it's another witness of Jesus Christ. And so when we are willing to wear these emblems, it reminds people that I am a follower of Jesus Christ. I'm a follower. I obey the will of God, right? Yes. I have what the Bible tells me. I have been crucified with Christ, for I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Amen? And because you believe in that, you know that I do carry my cross, and every day is a new day in Christ Jesus. And because it's a new day, my God, to supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. Amen? You have learned that. So when I think about committing above everything else and learning to say goodbye, I had to bring your father in this. When I was still a youth pastor, I remember Kenny used to always say, during one of the rallies, he said this. He made me kind of, I mean, everybody cringe. Are you willing to die for your faith? The people are reading this book. When I read this book, I'm reading about martyrs and people in the Middle East. They are willing to die for their faith. And I ask myself each time I read about one of the testimonies of these individuals, they were willing to die for their faith. If they were arrested, they would tell them, I'm going to grab your daughter, I'm going to brutalize her, denounce Jesus Christ. And they would. I said to myself, God, if somebody did that to me and grabbed one of my family members and said, denounce Jesus Christ or I'll kill her, would you be able to do that? And I thought of my brother who said, are you willing to die for your faith? Are you willing to carry your cross for Jesus Christ? Committed above everything else. And you have to be willing to say that to yourself. We say and we raise our hands in victory and we say, Jesus, I love you. I want to be more like you, Jesus. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. Well, the question begs this morning, are you truly a genuine follower of Jesus Christ? And if you, the answer to that is yes, then the answer is, I am willingly saying I will die for my faith. I will die for my faith. And I'm telling you, it's a hard question. And when we in America, we don't know what persecution is. Because you know what, when somebody asks you, are you a Christian, we cringe. We go, well, I go to church. But to be bold, yes, I'm a Christian. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. Yes. That's what God wants us to do. I'm committed above everything. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Father, I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for the people of God. And Father, I